1113, initiating broadcast of fascinating nouns in 3, 2, 1.
Hello everyone, and welcome to Fascinating Nouns. Now, if you are listening to this transmission, we are still the galaxy's most trusted source for incredible people, places, things, and ideas. Now together we arrive at this curious nexus point, and we will explore the strange, unusual, offbeat, bizarre, intriguing, interesting, invigorating, quirky, quaint, quizzical, weird, wild, wacky, the fun, the frivolous, and the fringe, plus all the spaces in between. I am your host, Daniel J. Glenn.
Hello, Fascination. Welcome to the show. So today's episode is going to be an exploration into a topic that I don't know much about, but this one comes as a sequel, almost, to a previous episode that I did with Anthony Amore about Rose Dugdale and the way that she stole these very priceless paintings done by Vermeer. Now, why is that episode interesting? Because it talks about how and why people steal priceless artwork. You know, this stuff's very difficult to flip. It's hard to sell. So why do people do it? That's a great episode to kind of learn about why people do it. Because today's episode is going to be great because I'm talking to Chris Marinello, who helps recover those stolen pieces of art. And that takes a very special set of skills that he possesses to be able to track down these thieves. You know, and some of these priceless pieces of art have been missing for decades. So how do you track it down? How do you get people to give it up? Where do your tips come from? Especially if this stuff's, you know, 20, 30 years old. You know, what's going on here? How do we get these important pieces of history in some cases? How do we get them back? We're going to find that all out today. So I'm excited. Let's just jump right into this with Chris Marinello. Chris, first of all, thank you so much for being on the show today. And second of all, you have such a wealth of knowledge because you've been doing this a long time. I mean, you've been doing this, what, like 35 years, you know, in this stolen art world, like tracking criminals down. And, you know, you're almost like a film noir-esque kind of PI, right?
Well, I am an attorney it does require a lot of investigative work, but you know, most attorneys are trained in investigative work when they're checking out facts and circumstances and previous case law. I mean, there is a investigative element to the profession.
I don't think I realized that. I mean, I'm not a lawyer, so I don't think I really realized that. But you know, I feel like, you know, from what I've kind of read, is your like journey in, I mean, because it's an interesting switch, right? I mean, you're a lawyer trained in investigation, but now as a professional, I mean, your job is to track down stolen artwork, which, you know, is probably one of the coolest professions out there. I mean, you know, professional video game player and maybe ice cream taste tester are on that list, but it's a short list of pretty cool jobs. How did you get from lawyer to, you know, art PI?
Well, I went to art school a very long time ago, and it's really what I enjoy doing in my spare time is drawing. And I was encouraged by my family to try something else, which might give you an idea of my quality of my drawing. But it's something I really enjoy doing. I love the art world, and I love being in it. And if the art world was not going to have me as an artist, they were going to have me as someone who recovered stolen art and mediated disputes involving artists and complicated art disputes. So that's how I got into it.
You know, I was looking, I think this came from your website, Art Recovery. I think it's artrecovery.com. We'll get to, yes. Is that right? Yeah. So on there, this is a quote. I believe it's from your website. So I want to preface that, you know, right off the bat here. It says, Marinello is a one-time art student whose teachers and family members looked at his work and actively encouraged him to try a different career. That I know art critics can be, you know, notoriously harsh, but that seems brutal. I mean, was it that bad?
Well, listen, you know, my family is very practical, and they were like, go out, make some money, and then when you make a lot of money, you can retire and become an artist. So I think financial considerations had a lot to do with it. It was go out and get a real job.
Well, I mean, you know, Hitler was an art student as well, and he got a different job. So
You ever had that comparison or no?
Yeah, I wish they would have kept him in art school. The world would have been a different place.
Yeah, for sure. So, I mean, I imagine, you know, 35 years is a long time to be in this business. Now, I imagine, and I could be wrong here, but, you know, what was your first case like? I envision it, you know, you being about 12, 13 years old and kind of recovering someone, you know, stealing art from the refrigerator or, you know, someone's office wall or something like that. What was your first case that got you kind of into recovering lost art?
Well, my very first case was in 1988, if that gives you an idea. Oh, wow. And I was an attorney, and an art gallery came to me and said, look, we've got some problems. Can you help us out? And I resolved the dispute. And of course, you know, an art gallery in New York City was had some issues with financing. And of course, after the successful conclusion of their case, they had no money to pay me. So they paid me in artwork. And that turned out to be a regular fee structure over the years, representing artists and art galleries that were found themselves in some trouble. And they would say, well, we have no way to pay you. Can you take this stuff? So I the more stuff I got, the more I became interested in collecting art and building my own personal collection.
Oh, that's interesting. So people paid you, was it pieces of the art you recovered, or was it other art that they had in storage that wasn't, you know?
No, it was usually artwork. Like, you know, I do a lot of pro bono work for artists. I mean, right. as a failed artist, I feel sorry for artists. They're incredibly sure. talented yeah, people. Yeah. Uh-huh. And, you know, they run into problems all the time. And, you know, they don't always make the best decisions. They consign works of art without written agreements. Yep, they don't do due diligence on the people they're dealing with. And then, you know, often their artwork goes missing. They don't get paid. And I will step up and do what I can to get back their life's work in some circumstances. And they are grateful and appreciative, but they can't pay me. So, you know, they'll send me a work of art. You know, I am grateful, but one cannot live on representing artists alone. Trust me.
Well, I mean, it's funny because they're paying you in the currency that they're living off of themselves, right? So
yeah, that's true. That's true.
You know what I mean? So they're not doing well financially, but they're paying you in that. But so I don't think I realized that. So you must have quite an art collection yourself then.
Well, I don't keep everything. I mean, let's face it. I mean, this one artist who only did erotica and nudes wanted to pay me in something that I could never hang in my house anywhere, even the bathroom. Uh-huh. So I was like, thank you, but don't worry about it. It's okay. I just considered this a freebie and try not to get into trouble again.
Yeah. Have you ever seen The Shining?
I have.
So there's a scene where Carruthers is at home. This is when he's getting The Shining. It's late in the movie where he's moved back to Florida or whatever. And he's sitting in his bed watching television. And above him on the wall is this great erotic painting that I love. And that just made me think of that because I think he had like two or three in that scene. And that's the funniest painting, you know. I mean, it creates for some awkward moments when people come over.
I'm a pretty conservative guy, so that's not something I would hang.
Sure, sure. Yeah, you don't seem like, you know, he seems like a very different guy than you were. Not just the psychic abilities aside. So one of the things, you know, one of the myths that I think in a lot of interviews that you kind of dispel in a way, but I want to know if that's really true, is when I watch, there's a lot of movies on art theft. And it makes it seem like two things. Number one, that art theft is pretty common, which I can't believe that it is. And number two, that the art thieves are all, you know, upper crust, debonair, attractive thieves who are stealing it, you know, with the best intentions in mind. Is there any truth to any of this at all?
Okay, well, what is true is that that art theft happens every single day. I get reports anywhere from 5 to 15 a day somewhere in the world of looting, museum theft, some kind of a personal, a private collector had something stolen, an art fraud case. So it's happening every single day. And art crime is more than just taking a painting off the wall of someone's house. It involves fakes, forgeries, and increasingly fraudulent behavior.
Okay.
And now with the rise of these NFTs, we're seeing, you know, even more crypto art and crypto fraud taking place. So, you know, there's all different kinds of art crime. So there, yes, art crime happens every day. Now, the second part of your question is, are these characters romantic, intelligent, debonair, suave? No, they're not. Most of the people I deal with are common thugs. And the only reason they steal art is not for the love of the artwork, it's because they know that they can get cash out of it. These are just common thugs that would steal from their own mother. There's nothing romantic about them. There's nothing attractive about them. You know, they don't always think about the next step after they commit a crime, and they certainly don't think about what they're doing to the collector or to the museum or to the world when they are committing their crime. It's all about how can they convert what they've just done to fast cash and move on.
Well, there has to be some debonair, sexy art criminals. Or do they just not get caught?
Well, if you happen to know them, let point them in my direction.
That's fair.
I see nothing but ugly thugs.
Now, I do sense, you know, a little something in your voice here. Is your connection to art and your love of the art world, does that kind of upset you that these people take it and ruin it?
Well, they really don't understand what they're doing. I mean, when they take something from a church, they think, oh, well, you know, let me flip this and get, you know, $50 for it. They don't realize that people go into the church and worship.
Yeah.
And that the object they've just stolen, I mean, forget about whether it's worth, you know, $50 or $500,000. It's something that helps people with their worship. Mm-hmm. And the criminals don't realize that when they just snap it off the wall and run out of the church. And that's what really makes me mad. You know, they'll take something that has been created, a beautiful sculpture that you know, weighs tons, and they'll melt it down for the pure metal value, you know, so that people can no longer appreciate it. And it's just reduced to some scrap metal for them to get a couple of $100 out of. It's the second crime after the actual theft.
Yeah. No, that makes perfect sense to me. I mean, you know, you're talking about pieces of art that have to be handled by professionals. And even then there's risk of damage, however slight. But, you know, you got some, you know, grubby pawed, thug who's just rolling it up and sticking it in, you know, in their back pocket or whatever as they run out of the museum. I can understand that. I mean,
entire process, you know, the handling of from the criminal, the recovery process, what happens with the artwork that has been missing for all these years. You know, I've had artwork, stolen artwork, returned to me in a black plastic garbage bag through the window of a Mercedes.
Wow.
And then if the police are involved, it's the handling of the artwork in the police station itself.
Yeah.
You know, I had this $1 million painting that was being passed around by police officers in one state. I don't want to name it, but they were passing the painting around during their Christmas party and saying, look, guys, this is worth $1 million.
Ay, ay, ay.
So, no, it's nothing's good after artwork is stolen.
Well, I think in one interview you called the thieves cultural barbarians, but in some ways, you know, and not to disparage police officers, but, you know, when you don't have when you're ignorant of the value, the cultural value of something, I mean, they almost sound just as bad as the thieves, because I'm guessing the thieves ran around taking selfies with this $1 million painting as well. You know, they're pretty excited to show that off.
Yeah. There's, you know, it's not just police officers that aren't always trained. It's even myself. I was handling a $30 million Matisse, and I was being, one of my staff yelled at me and said, put the gloves on. So, you know, it can be anybody.
Sure. You know, this conversation reminds me of this. I did an interview with a guy named Anthony Amore, who's the head of security for the Isabel Stewart Gardner Museum. And that was the site, I'm sure, as you know, and the listeners will as well, but that was the site of the largest art theft in history, which is still, you know, unsolved. Now, Anthony wasn't in charge. He wasn't the head of security then when it was robbed, you know, to be fair to him. But he wrote this book on the a female thief named Rose Dugdale, who was unique, A, because mm-hmm. she was a female, but also because when she stole Vermeer's, the name of the book is Vermeer's in the title, and those are, you know, require a trained eye to really spot them out, and they're quite valuable. But you know, she doesn't fit this mold that you're talking about, because she was robbing them for political purposes to use as ransom for, you know, the IRA in Ireland or whatever. It's much more mm-hmm. complex. But she does strike me as one of these unique cases where you do have an intelligent art aficionado who then turns to crime, but does handle everything with the gentle touch of a, you know, someone who, of a connoisseur, you know, so they do exist. Some of them.
Listen, that's a rare instance. Sure. In from what I've seen. And listen, I have a great deal of respect for Anthony, and I'm happy that we're plugging his book on my podcast.
Sorry. Well, I'm plugging my podcast on my podcast, which is even worse.
It's great. But I have not run into many Rose Dugdales. I've run into some people who claim, you know, after they get caught, they say, "Oh, I stole this Kandinsky because, you know, I'm protesting the current politics in Poland." And I'm like, "Well, you don't know anything about the current politics in Poland. You're just a criminal." I mean, they try to make an excuse, but you know, it's really, then why did you try to sell the thing 50 times and finally get caught when you tried to sell it to an FBI agent? I mean, it just doesn't make any sense. But there are not that many Rose Dugdales out there.
All right, that's fair. But you know, if we can't talk about sexy criminals, we can talk about, you know, quote unquote sexy crimes, because there are a lot of very interesting high profile crimes that have been committed. You know, the Scream was stolen and then recovered. You know, several Van Goghs have been stolen and recovered. You know, the Isabel Stewart Gardner theft, that's still unsolved. The Dresden Green Vault robberies, you know, those are also pretty famous, which I think you've talked about on a couple of shows. And the video, I mean, the video of that robbery is truly brutal if you're an art fan. Have you ever, you know, I imagine these high profile cases, you know, cracking those cases has got to be exciting. Do you work on those? Do you think they're solvable? You know, is the Isabel Stewart Gardner Museum, are those pieces of art even still around? I mean, these have to be the ones that keep you up at night as an art fan.
Well, I do think the Isabella Stewart Gardner paintings are still out there. I believe that the possessors are somewhat skittish about accepting the reward, as dramatic as that reward is, $10 million.
Yeah.
I think they're afraid that somebody's going to come forward and arrest them. And even though the district attorneys have said that there would not be a criminal charge in most cases, I think that there needs to be an intermediary. And I've volunteered my services pro bono if the possessors wanted to come forward and use my escrow account to have the museum deposit the $10 million and put the paintings in escrow, and then we make the swap so they never have to deal directly with law enforcement. And you know, I've discussed this with Anthony and with the FBI, and I think it's getting that possibility out there might help bring these paintings back to the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum, because what, you know, it's been over 30 years and nothing else has worked.
Yeah, nothing at all. I mean, everything's still out. So, I mean, that's an interesting proposal. That makes me wonder, how does that recovery process go? Like, I mean, from the time something is stolen or someone contacts you, obviously, you know, that particular theft is a, you know, cold case. 30 years is quite a long time. So I imagine the process for, you know, a newly stolen piece of art versus a cold case is different, but they must parallel in some ways to, you know, almost like a kidnapping in some ways, you know?
Well, there's no, you know, there's countless different scenarios, but I'll give you a general idea of what happens after something is stolen. It gets reported to the police. If it's a big enough theft, it makes it to the press. In the old days, something stolen in London wouldn't be reported in the United States, you know, right away. It would take a while. But mm-hmm. with the internet, it's instant. So things have changed dramatically. So the news of a theft is everywhere now. And then what will happen is they will the thief will then try to unload the object quickly. If it's a high profile thing, they might wait for an insurance company to appear and they'll read the press. I sometimes get contacted because I represent many of the fine art insurance companies out there. And they want to know if there's a reward or they actually ransomed the artwork back. I mean, there's a difference between reward and ransom. Mm-hmm. Your listeners need to know that a reward is offered by an insurance company with law enforcement approval for information that leads to the recovery of the artwork, but not to the thief. They won't pay any criminals. And a ransom is when the criminal themselves or somebody connected to the criminals or a possessor says, look, I'm not going to tell you where this artwork is unless you wire 20,000 euros of Bitcoin to this account.
Right.
I mean, that's a ransom. So we don't get involved in ransoms. We've never paid a ransom. We won't pay a ransom. Now, rewards, we have paid out where it's legal and where it was authorized by law enforcement and where the conditions were met. So the thief, after they try to unload the artwork, they will try to ransom it or collect some sort of a reward. Or they will try to sell it in the marketplace, and they may find that particularly difficult. There's always people out there that will buy something, no questions asked, and that's unfortunate. But the more high profile a work of art is, the hotter it becomes and the harder it becomes to sell. That's when they can't make a sale. The artwork will then trade for years, if not decades, on some sort of a black market where at a fraction of its true value, where criminals will buy and sell and at a very small fraction of its value or exchange it for drugs or weapons or some other criminal will take a chance on it. Now, stolen artwork surfaces years later when the criminals, you know, die or somebody else steals it from them and or somebody tries to put it into the marketplace surreptitiously. And we work with a number of databases that would locate, that would spot these stolen works of art when they're introduced into the marketplace or offered for sale. Or if somebody checks one of these databases, whether it's the FBI database, Interpol, there are a number of private databases, one that we set up. So this is how we find stolen works of art more than any other way, is when they get placed for sale.
That, I mean, that makes a lot of sense. But and I was reading that a lot of your information comes from other thieves as well, when they kind of turn on each other, either for the reward money or, you know, maybe that other thief did something to them. So, I mean, there's a lot of interesting ways where you can kind of get tips. And there was one story where you've had to deal with a lot of mafia members as well, and you've had your life threatened over artwork, which seems crazy. It also seems crazy to me that the mafia would be interested in art, but I imagine that has to happen.
Well, I think all criminal organizations and criminals individually are interested in artwork because it's fast cash. Mm-hmm. It's easy to transport. You can put it in a suitcase, move it around. You know, it's another form of currency when they need currency.
Right.
But you know, it's, you know, so that's what thieves will do after something is stolen. The recovery process is entirely something else altogether. That kind of depends on where the object is found, who contacts me. Sometimes victims themselves find their objects and say, what do? I found my mother's artwork being sold on eBay.
Oh, wow.
They don't know what to do.
What do they do?
Well, I invite them to call me and I'll sort it out for them. But unfortunately, what they often do is write to the guy on eBay saying, you have my stolen artwork. And that's the last they hear of them.
Right. Yep.
You know,
yeah.
And if the matter happens to be an open criminal case with a law enforcement agency, that agency needs to be notified. And we always notify the police when we know that the case is an open cold case.
You know, one of the things I think someone was asking you if whether you know your job was sexy. I think you've even been compared to Rene Russo from the Thomas Crown Affair, and your response was, I mean, obviously you don't strike me as Rene Russo, but your response was interesting in that you said that. You really, what you do is it's not sexy at all. You basically make a bunch of phone calls, do research, and argue with people all day. Like that's essentially your job.
I do spend a lot of time arguing and negotiating. Right. The first step is to prove that something is stolen. So, you know, you have to dig up the police report. You have to, and then they say, "Well, how do we know that this is the same painting?" So then we have to deal with. You know, the actual painting itself, the artwork itself, and show why it's exactly the same watch or the same car or the same painting. Then we also have to deal with the provenance. Well, you know, this could be another version. Well, then we look at the provenance of the stolen artwork and the provenance of the one that they have. Mm-hmm. Were they both, you know, exhibited in Vienna in 1951, you know, were they both in the hands of this one particular collector? And this way we create a match. We say, look, unequivocally, this is the same work of art. It was stolen. It has now been found. You're in possession of it. That's when the negotiation starts. Well, then they say, well, I bought it in good faith. It was, you know, under the laws of my jurisdiction. And that's when I have to put my legal hat back on because the laws of the U.S. and the U.K. are different from those in France and Switzerland and Germany. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I have to sort out the laws of different jurisdictions, different places of purchase, different places of sale, and different places of theft. So it can get extremely complicated. And the more valuable a work of art is, the more lawyers come out of the woodwork. I settled a case over a £36 million, that's almost $50 million Degas. There were six sets of lawyers involved.
Wow.
And I had to sort it all out. Everyone had their own interest in it. One billionaire wanted to buy it from another billionaire, and there was a Nazi looted art claim connected to it, and it was just a mess. And it took months of negotiation and deal making to make everybody reasonably happy.
I like that. Reasonably happy is about as close as you can get. I guess that is a success.
That's it. So that is, there's a lot of negotiating going on here. Yeah. It's very rare that I approach a dealer and say, look, that work of art that you have on the wall is stolen. And they hand it back to me and say, oh, I want nothing to do with stolen art. And it's again, the case is over.
Right.
That has happened before. By some very reputable dealers that I have dealt with over the years, but it's not typical.
You mentioned the, you know, a Nazi looting claim. That's kind of an interesting aspect of your work because I don't want to put words, you know, into your story here, but it seems like you kind of specialize in that or at least deal with it a lot. And this seems like a very tricky topic for a lot of different reasons, not the least of which is, as you mentioned, you're an international company dealing with laws that are different in every country in the world, including, you know, even in Europe, all the countries there are all very different. That has to be very tricky to navigate as you, you know, kind of investigate some of these Nazi looting claims. How often, I mean, are there, I think I was reading, you know, one article about how there's like these caches of Nazi, you know, looted art that show up. How do you, when you stumble across something like that, how does that all get figured out?
Well, the first step is you have to have brilliant art historians working with you and provenance researchers. And I do have some that are just incredible. And why I say that is because they help build the case. Mm-hmm. They show that a painting belonged to a certain family that was murdered during the Holocaust and where it was before the war and where it was during the war and what happened immediately after. And they are able to put together the claim for me to show why this painting belongs to somebody else. Mm-hmm. I then can approach the museum or the collector that has it and say, look, without a doubt, this painting was looted from this family before they were murdered. The next question is, you know, I then get approached by a lawyer for a museum or a collector saying, well, okay, we agree it was looted, but we bought it in good faith under the law of our country, Norway or whatever it might be, and we intend to keep it. And that's when I then need to develop a strategy on how to get it back to the family, how to get restitution, despite the fact that, you know, horrendous things happened to these people. They were murdered and their objects were taken from them, and their lives were taken from them, and their possessions were taken from them, and their history was taken from them. And some people just don't care. Mm-hmm. You know, I've got a case going right on right now where a dealer sold a Nazi-looted painting to one of his clients in Switzerland, and he couldn't care less. He said the provenance that he gave was, oh, the family that owned this, they bought it in Paris in 1942. Well, that's no kind of provenance. The Nazis ran Paris in 1942.
Yeah.
So, I mean, seriously. And so now I'm putting pressure on the German government to put pressure on this private dealer to do something, because the principles that are in place for covering Nazi looted art, these Washington principles of 1988, they don't apply to private individuals or dealers. And so I am trying to get the German government, I'm dealing with the authorities in Germany, to put pressure on this dealer to release the name of the current possessor so that I could then at least have a meeting and discuss terms.
Oh, I see.
But they are putting every obstacle in my way, because in Germany, the rights of the private individual outweigh the rights of the Holocaust victims that suffered at the hands of the National Socialists in Germany. And that's got to change.
That's kind of shocking, given how much, you know, both the German government and the German people would want to put that behind them. Because, I mean, it is kind of what people think about when they hear Germany. I mean, I hate to say that, but that's, you know, it's still 80 years later, you know.
You can't put something behind you unless you deal with it head on.
Right. Yeah.
And Germany does not want to do that. They want to talk about it. They want to shake hands with a lot of people and the World Jewish Congress. They love to shake hands with people from the World Jewish Congress. But, you know, let's see some deeds, less words.
Yeah. Yeah. I completely agree. But I mean, because it is so tangled, and it seems like a one-sided story. I mean, I understand that people, you know, maybe they bought it in good faith or whatever. But I mean, there has to, at some point, the atrocities that brought that painting to your possession, that has to weigh on someone's, you know, moral compass. But it seems like
you would think that more people would be receptive to that thought that you just, you know, you just said. I mean, but you'd be surprised. I have looked at dealers in the eye and said, this family was murdered in Auschwitz. Nothing has ever been recovered from them except one painting, one painting that went through your sale room, and they look at me blankly like I'm from Mars. They couldn't care less. And then there's a pause, and then they say, oh, but we paid X amount of euros for this. So that's really what it comes down to. It's all about money.
Well, there's this interesting, so I don't want to get ahead of myself, because I want to get a couple of your stories, because you actually deal with a lot of different things, including stolen cars, stolen watches. So it's not just limited to paintings and traditional artwork. But there, I was reading this one story about a stolen watch, and this was so interesting to me, both because Richard, is it Millet? Is that how you say it?
It's Millet.
Mie? Of course, I mispronounced it.
But we can call it Richard Mille because we're both speaking English.
Sure. But, you know, it's funny, first of all, how many of his watches get stolen and how much they're worth, given how ugly they are, if I can say that as a non-artist. They're not my style. Let me just say that. They're not my style.
Well, yeah, I don't want to call them ugly.
No, that's me.
There's a lot of people that love that. They look like Formula One race cars on your wrist. Yeah. That's what they... That, and if that's what you are into, then God bless
you. Yeah, exactly. I take full responsibility for my words there. But, you know, so anyway, they get stolen. And it's this interesting story where one gets stolen in London, I believe. It ends up in Dubai. Someone buys it from a merchant in Dubai. 2 years later, it goes in for service, you know, traditional, regular service at an official Richard Millet
Richard Mier.
A service, you know, official servicing, and then, you know, pops up in a database because they're all serial numbered because, you know, there's only 30 in existence or whatever. And, you know, it comes down like, hey, this is a stolen watch. So the purchaser wants their money back from the person they bought it from. And I think you got in touch with, like, the dealer to try to figure out who actually was the thief in this situation to try to hold them responsible or whatever. And it was funny because then you talk about the chain that goes on from there, which is the guy who bought it wants his money back from the person he bought it from. You know, the I think it's like authentic luxury watches in Dubai. But then that seller, instead of contacting the police working with them, asks for his money back from the person he bought it from. And it just, you know, that passing the buck goes all the way down to the thief. Which is just such an interesting way to go about it. Instead of like working with authorities, everyone just wants their money back. You know,
well, I mean, we call that downlining. Sure, so, yeah. You know, we you know, do that tracking and sometimes I will help each part of the chain get their money from the person that sold it to them. But as you keep going down and down the chain, you eventually find somebody who bought without asking questions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there will be people say, well, I bought this watch at Sotheby's in Hong Kong. Okay, well, that's, you know, that's fine. And they say, well, I bought that from a jeweler in Dubai. Okay, that's fine. But then, you know, you eventually reach the guy that said, you know, I bought it from a guy named Fred on the street corner. Well, that's the guy that loses out. Okay.
Yeah.
That's you don't do due diligence when you're buying from a guy named Fred on the street corner.
Sure, right. Yeah.
You've got to find out where did the watch come from, and you're taking a chance. You could lose everything.
Yeah.
So, you know, and as you dig even deeper, when you reach Fred on the street corner, either Fred's the thief himself or he bought it from the thief. He's a fence.
Yeah.
And we very rarely dig even beyond that to that thief, because that's the job of law enforcement. You know, they're the ones with the guns and the badges. I'm interested in getting the object back to the victim, and it's the police that are interested in most of the time interested in solving the crime and getting the collar.
Sure, right. And taking that piece of artwork and passing it around at an office party first.
At a Christmas party. Right. Yeah,
you do that first.
On occasion.
You know, but it's interesting because you know, you're so into this. You created this website called Art. Is it Artive? ARTIVE, right? .org?
Yeah, we've converted it to a public database now. It's a for-profit enterprise, and we're relaunching it as the Art Claim Database shortly. So that people can, it'll serve as a private database for stolen and looted works of art.
I mean, it's a fantastic database. And on your website, the Art Recovery website, you have a lot of thief alerts, which remind me, I loved going through them because it was very similar to going on the FBI's most wanted list and seeing, like, you know, who's the FBI looking for now. But you know, you have a couple of great, you know, things that are, you know, currently stolen that you're actively working on. I was very surprised to find two Norman Rockwell paintings that have been stolen that you're looking for. And I love Norman Rockwell, but it was interesting to look at it because, you know, you think of like your famous painters, Picasso, Munch, Dali, Van Gogh, Monet. I don't put Rockwell or, you know, Bob Ross. I love his stuff too. I don't put them in the same category, but it's just interesting to see them on your website. But I imagine, I mean, is there a market for stolen Norman Rockwells?
Yes, of course there is. Rockwell's work is incredible. I mean,
I love it.
Particularly my style. But you know something? Have you ever sat and looked at a Norman Rockwell work of art? It's extremely soothing. It brings you back to a different time when the world was simpler and there weren't Kabul problems cyber fraud issues. So they're very nice paintings. But I will recover anything. As long as it means something to somebody and is uniquely identifiable, it doesn't have to be a $50 million painting. It could be, you know, somebody's wedding ring. As long as it's, you know, if it says it's engraved, you know, to my wife, Anna, then it's identifiable. Mm-hmm. And I will work on it.
Yeah.
And if I find it, I'll return it. So, you know, it really depends. And people are pretty upset when they lose something. You know, a lot of this artwork isn't just, you know, for the money. It means something to people.
Right. Yeah. No, and I agree with you. Look, I love Norman Rockwell's paintings. It was just funny to see two of them on the website.
Well, yeah. You know, when I do a lot of work for insurance companies, right, and right. when something is of, you know, a particular client says, we've got to have these back, please put out a theft alert. You know, I will do that. And we will, often we get tips for everything from Norman Rockwell's to, you know, the James Bond car and all other watches. And sometimes they pan out and sometimes they don't.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's true. I love that you brought up the James Bond car, because I wanted to go to stolen cars next, because this was something you have a couple of them on your theft alert on your website as well. But the James Bond car, this is a really interesting story. There's actually an entire podcast dedicated. I think it's called The Great James Bond Car Robbery. First of all, I love antique cars. I'm here in Los Angeles, where there's the Nethercutt Museum. I'm walking distance from the Peterson Auto Museum, and these are world-class auto museums. There's a Duesenberg at the Nethercutt, which is the most beautiful piece of machinery I have ever seen. So these are obviously, this is big business. They are works of art, and you recover them as well, which must be very tricky. But this, we're talking about the Aston Martin from Goldfinger. This was owned by a private collector in Florida. It has such a great story. Because it basically, it was in a hangar. Someone came in the middle of the night. They were able to not only steal it, but fly it out of the airport undetected. And then it just kind of went into the wind. How did you get involved with this case? Because you're quoted as calling this your white whale.
Well, I mean, you're right. The Spyscape has recently done a fantastic series narrated by Elizabeth Hurley. And this is one of my clients, the insurance company that paid out on the theft in 1997. And they've asked me to try to locate the car. And we agreed to do the podcast, which was my first podcast. This is maybe my third, but or second. I don't know. But
you're doing great, by the way, Christopher. You're doing great.
Well, thank you. It's something that I wanted to do to get the word out that I was getting closer. I had a few months ago, I got a very good tip from someone who claimed to have seen the car. Uh-huh. Now, I get tips all the time because there's many, many silver Aston Martin DB5s out there in the world. Mm-hmm. But there's only one with the plate DP216-1. And this particular individual called me and he said, I seen the car, I know the car, and he described something that only someone who had seen this car would know, which was particularly intriguing. And so we said, all right, let's cooperate with this podcast company, Spyscape. They're going to do a great job and get the word out there, and maybe I can reach the collector that has it before I have to contact them directly. Because we know we've got a good sense of who the collector is and high net worth individual, particularly important, you know, and we want them to send their handlers to me and arrange a meeting, and we could resolve this amicably and discreetly.
Sounds so clandestine.
Well, listen.
Cloak and dagger, man. It is spy. You're a spy. You are.
High net worth individuals don't like publicity. Sure. Publicity is bad for business. It's bad for everything. And it's bad in the art world. So, you know, a lot of my colleagues who love to bring lawsuits over these types of cases, this is not what my clients want. They want, because lawsuits are public, and you could find out who's litigious and who's not. You know, who's involved in a stolen art case and who's not. You know, this way I meet in a room in an office, I hammer out a deal, and no one ever hears about it.
Well, it's an interesting story, because with that particular car, and what a lot of people, you know, what was new information for me, let's say, is when an insurance company pays out for a particular item that's insured, like let's say this Aston Martin DB5, the owner, who the guy who bought it, he no longer technically owns it. He's been paid out whatever $6 million or whatever it was back in the 90s, late 97 or whatever. And now the insurance company is technically the owner of that car. And so they have, you know, obviously a vested interest in getting it back. But my question is, if you're, let's say you happen to recover this DB Martin, this this Aston Martin DB5. Who, and let's say the original owner wants it back, which would make sense. How is that arranged?
Well, I mean, I do this all the time. A lot of the artwork I recover is insured, and it is owned by the insurance company when the item is recovered. And some of the better fine art insurance companies will offer the works of art back to their clients, back to their victims. Mm-hmm. And say, look, you know, this was stolen from you 20 years ago. Marinello recovered it. We're offering it back to you, and you just need to pay us back what we paid you 20 years ago. You know, it really depends on what the wording of the policy. Sometimes it's a straight out pay us back what we paid you. Sometimes it includes the costs. Sometimes it's at fair market value. Right. Yeah. And a lot of times I get people that say, well, you know, thank you, but I've already replaced that watch. I've already replaced the artwork. I don't want it back. I'm happy with the insurance proceeds that I got. You know, it's you know, they don't always want the artwork back. And then I end up having to sell it, consign it for sale to various galleries or dealers or auction houses that I work with around the world. However, in the car world, it's very strange. Car collectors are so incredibly passionate about their vehicles, they very rarely let the insurance company take over.
Right.
They want that car back because they may have spent their entire life looking for that color, that model, right, that engine, yep, that, you know, and that's why you see so many of those cars on my website, because the owners call me and say, please put out a theft alert. You know, that was my life's dream, that car, and it's gone. You know, and they don't want the insurance money. They just want their car back.
No, and I imagine that's, you know, there's a lot of that. I mean, out here in LA, I mean, you know, Jay Leno is, you know, famous for having an amazing car collection, which I have seen, and it is quite a collection. And there are everything in there he has, you know, there's some kind of connection to. So if something were to be stolen, right, he would want the car back. The money's irrelevant.
Yeah, he could easily take the money and buy another version of it, or even a better version. Sure. But to him, it's the connection to that purchase. And that's something only a true automotive collector can understand.
Yeah, no, that's true. You know, and there's another, this, I don't know if you do this or not, but this just made me think of this that I wanted to bring up. There's, I think it was December of 2020 here in Los Angeles. There was a 310-year-old violin stolen. It was a 1710 Amati. And it was basically taken out of a person's car. The owner wasn't a musician, but they were an art dealer. And they would let people, you know, they would let people use the violin, you know, for orchestras and things like that. It's, I mean, quite an impressive violin, to say the least, and absolutely a piece of art. Have you ever dealt with anything like that? I mean, or is that kind of, I imagine that's got to be in your wheelhouse somewhere.
That particular case is.
Oh, no
so
kidding.
I can't get into too many details about it, but I can say that I've recovered stolen musical instruments before. Uh-huh. It's very strange because most of the instruments are lost because the musicians are a bit scatterbrained and leave them in taxi cabs or on trains. I mean, this is their life's work, and it's an extension of their arms and legs and hands and feet, and somehow they just let them go. Uh-huh. You know, maybe they're thinking about their performance, or, you know, they have a, you know, just a different artistic mentality that they're so wound up in what they're going to do that they forget their instrument. You know, it's very rare that you have a break in and they grabbed the violin. You know, it's usually, oh, we left it on the seat of the taxi cab and now it's showing up in Holland at an auction house. You know, so, but I have worked on those cases and they're just like anything else, just like another fine work of art.
So with this particular case, the one from December 2020, can you give anything that you're working on, or is it pretty hush hush?
No, I can't.
Nothing, huh?
So I'm giving you nothing on that.
are you knocking on the door on this guy? I hope, because this is a pretty fantastic violin. Out here in LA, you must have done a lot of work. Is there any case that really kind of sticks out as memorable out here on the West Coast?
Well, one of my favorite LA-based cases was about $20 million worth of artwork was taken from a family in Beverly Hills.
Wow.
And this was in 2008, and I was interviewed by one of the newspapers at the time about the theft. And then years later, I got a phone call from a guy named Darko from the Balkans.
Whoa. I thought
he was kidding me. Yeah. I thought he was kidding me, but that was his name. And he said he knew where these artworks were. And he sent photos which matched the photos that we had on our database. This guy knew where the objects were. And we set up a sting operation with the LAPD. And instead of being Don the insurance guy, we set up Don the LAPD officer. And that officer took over the role that I had originally set up and worked with Darko to recover the artwork, $20 million worth of Warhols and other paintings. And Darko turned out to be eligible for the reward, which was considerable because he was not the thief. The LAPD was able to make the arrest with the assistance of the FBI. And almost right. Everybody was happy. The LAPD had a press conference and said that they recovered all this artwork thanks to an overseas tip. No mention of our work, of my work. But,
and Darko from the Balkans got paid.
Oh, yeah. He got paid out very well. That's right.
That's a great story.
So I'm working on a $5 million watch right now that was stolen from Athens, Greece, and is being offered for sale on Instagram.
Whoa, okay? Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. I mean, that's so bizarre. I mean, it's really like from the penthouse to the outhouse, right? I mean, normally you would go down Rodeo Drive here in Los Angeles, buy a high-end watch, you know, walk around town, whatever. It gets stolen and it ends up on Instagram, which is social media, right? I mean, you know, it's just such a strange turn of events, you know?
Right, but the thief doesn't have the original papers, so they can't sell the watch for its true value. Mm-hmm. They have to deal in the margins, and someone will always take a chance on it. But we encourage people, don't buy rare watches, don't buy fine automobiles, don't buy fine art from anybody you don't know, and that doesn't give you a full provenance. You have to do due diligence before you buy anything today, anything. Yeah. We do it. We buy a washing machine, right?
Right.
You do it when you buy a toaster. You want to find out the best reviews on your toaster. Right. But why will people buy things like art and million-dollar watches without doing any due diligence at all? It's crazy.
Right, yeah. I want to close with a couple of fun stories that that I really enjoyed. The first one is about a watch. And I want to get a couple of details on this because this seemed, you know, like something out of the North Pole. It's a story where another Richard Millier, I hope I'm getting that right, number 11. Now, this was stolen when a guy's, the owner, his basement flooded, and I think it was in a safe, and he pulled it out of the safe because he didn't want it to get ruined. He put it on his patio to dry, and then he comes back out, and it's gone. I believe you got involved, ends up all over the world, and somehow a reindeer gets blamed for stealing this watch. I'm sure that that's an oversimplification. What actually happened in this story?
Well, the police report and the insurance report actually had the language that you just said. There was the man had a flood in his basement, put his watch and some other jewelry outside to dry, and then it was gone. And he couldn't figure out how a human could have gotten into his yard. He did say that he had reports of deer that were in his backyard that were eating his flowers or his plants or whatever it was. And he was convinced that the deer saw the shiny object and picked it up and off he went. Now, this case came to me like a gift from heaven just before Christmas because we're talking about
right,
a deer.
Exactly.
You know, there are no reindeer in the UK. It's probably was a roe deer, right. But, you know, we tweaked it a little bit to fit the holidays.
Sure, sure.
But that was a true story. That was the story the victim was going with. Okay. Uh-huh. And I hear stories like this all the time of, you know, artwork being lost behind sofas and you know, being taken by animals and husbands were blaming their wives and wives blaming their husbands. And I've heard it all.
So did that happen? I mean, did a reindeer actually take it?
Well, listen.
Or do you not know?
Like I said before, I rarely do I actually catch the thief.
Sure.
Okay. I get the watch back. I recover the watch for the victim. It's up to the police with the badges and the guns to track down the reindeer and interview him.
Right.
Why he stole what he
right.
stole.
You're not in animal control, for God's sakes.
That's it.
All right. So this last one, this is a great story. I'm going to let you tell this from beginning to end, but I'm going to give you a little reminder here. So this, I believe, is the first time you were trying to negotiate $100 million Picasso from a former art thief. You were meeting them in Amsterdam, and prior to this negotiation, you thought it would be a good idea to take your family on a vacation to Amsterdam while you negotiated this stolen piece of artwork. I'll let you pick up the story from there.
Oh, God, that was a disaster. I was going to Amsterdam to meet this art thief who was 80-something years old, and he had information on a very expensive Picasso, well over $100 million. And I told him, he asked me, what hotel are you staying in? And I told him, and but I took my family there because I think it was around Thanksgiving, and we were going to have Thanksgiving in Amsterdam, which is hard enough finding a place to
right,
serve
sure.
traditional American Thanksgiving. But we found one, and it was amazing. But anyway, the thief called the hotel and ended up going, you know, I had taken two rooms and ended up getting the room of my mother-in-law. And she comes in to breakfast and says, you know, there's some guy on the phone about a Picasso. And I was just had my hand in my head. It just was
right.
Like, what a mistake that was. So I immediately said, don't worry about it. I got it. I grabbed the phone, arranged the meeting and swore I would never do that again. So,
oh, you're lucky it wasn't like, you know, the head of the mafia or something like that you were arranging.
Well, listen, I felt reasonably comfortable with this sure. grandfatherly type sure. art thief, yeah. all dressed in black.
Another debonair art thief, right? No?
Well, he'd been arrested a number of times and served time in prison. I don't know how debonair he was, but he did know where a multi-million-dollar Picasso was.
Can't be all bad, right? I have to tell you, my favorite story is the 15th century astrolabe that you recovered. This is a great story. I'm going to try to find a picture and put it up, but this is, you know, an antique stargazing piece of equipment from the 15th century. This was pretty cool. The story is a little gruesome. But this was a pretty cool, this has to be, is this the most unique thing that you've recovered?
Well, it certainly is one of them. I mean, I was fascinated by this object and I did get a chance to play with it a little bit, with gloves on, of course.
Sure, sure,
but,
sure.
This was one of many items stolen, by it was an insider theft. It was stolen by one of the curators who had a habit for fast cars and Italian suits. And so he would take small objects and he would sell them in the marketplace at auction or to dealers. And this would feed his clothing habit. And eventually they caught him in the act of stealing from different libraries and museums around Sweden. And he fled to his apartment and tried to commit suicide by slitting his wrists. And just like being a failed thief, he failed at committing suicide and just ended up, you know, heavily bleeding all over the place.
Jeez.
So he turned the gas on in his apartment and let it go and lit a match and ended up blowing himself up along with half the building.
Jeez.
And part of the neighborhood. So that was the end of him. But the objects that he stole over the years are still finding their way into the marketplace. And this astrolabe was one of them. And it ended up in the hands of an Italian collector who immediately lawyered up and you know, but he happened to be very respectful. And when we showed him the provenance and showed him that it was stolen from the museum, he was extremely cooperative, sure, despite sure. the, you know, the usual, how could it be the same one? And you know, I bought it in good faith, but eventually, I twisted his arm and he agreed to give it back unconditionally to the museum. So, it was fascinating. And the museum itself is fascinating, called Skokloster Castle outside of Stockholm. I encourage anybody to visit that castle. It really was fascinating. And I was able to get a private tour as a gift for my pro bono efforts.
Sure. And if you go and visit the museum, you can check out this 15th century astrolabe that you had a hand in recovering. It's a pretty cool little thing there. So let's say you've got some people who have got some stolen artwork that they're sitting on, but they want to do the right thing. What can they do? Where can they find your database to upload it? How can they get in touch with you to make sure this gets back to their rightful owners?
The best way to contact me is artrecovery.com, chris@artrecovery.com. I will handle all tips discreetly and confidentially. You know, I get people all the time, you know, that come to me and say, look, my grandfather brought this back from the war, or I bought this and I think it's stolen. Now, there's a lot of, you know, spirited people out there that don't have stolen art that contact me with crazy stories, trying to blame family members. But you know, you never know if we get a good tip here and there, and we will assist artists and religious organizations at no cost. And but you know, we do represent a number of insurance companies, and people who have a theft should report the theft to their police, report it to their insurance company, and then they should contact us.
And do you do social media at all? People want to, you know, if they want to fence a watch or anything?
Yeah, we are active on Twitter @ArtRecovery. And we put in daily reports of art thefts that have happened around the world, of rewards that are being offered, of our own recoveries, and the stories right on Twitter @ArtRecovery. We're also on Instagram, but Twitter is where we release most of the information that we have.
Well, this has been an absolutely enlightening conversation. I love what you do. You say it's not sexy, but I think it is kind of. This is a pretty sexy job. Not a lot of people doing it, and definitely not a lot of people doing it with the proficiency that you have. And the art world thanks you. I thank you for all your hard work. And I also want to thank you for being on the show today.
Well, thank you. It's been just like having a beer with a friend in a bar.
Perfect. I've done my job. You've done yours. And I want to thank everyone for listening. Have a good night.
End of transmission.